Good afternoon. I'm pleased to welcome you to a conversation with Chancellor Milliken and UT President Jay Hartzell. As we plan to resume more in-person activities with the Chancellor's Council this fall, we'd still like to take advantage of virtual discussions when possible. I think all of us have come to believe that these conversations are really fruitful, and so we'll continue to do that as we can. You'll be getting invitations soon about our series on national security, cybersecurity, and look back at COVID with several UT COVID warriors whose work played a part in the global solutions of the vaccine. For now, we are pleased to introduce to you another UT president. Last fall, we met with Heather Wilson, president of UT El Paso. And then earlier in the spring, we met with Peter Pister's UT MD Anderson's president. Many of you already know our special guest this evening, Jay Hartzell, who was indoctrinated into the first year as UT Austin's president in ways that we could only imagine. And what a year it's been, from navigating the pandemic to establishing a more inclusive campus. President Hartzell has guided UT Austin with a steady, capable, and devout loyalty to Longhorns across the state and the nation. Maybe that's because he's no newcomer to the 40 acres. President Hartzell is a bona fide Texas ex, having earned a PhD in finance from UT in 1998. And after serving as assistant professor at NYU, he returned to Texas in 2001 to teach and conduct research at Macomb School of Business. Over the next two decades, he held a variety of leadership positions in the Macombs, including being the dean of the school. During his four-year tenure as dean, President Hartzell launched the Golf Real Estate Labs, opened Rolling Hall, the home of UT's MBA program, and helped create significant partnerships with colleges and schools across the campus. The launched new top-ranked undergraduate and graduate programs has worked very closely with civic and business leaders across the state and nation to advance the UT mission. Jay's experience as a student, faculty member, researcher, and administrator has provided him with a unique and deep perspective on what makes UT Austin great and what is needed to make it even greater. Despite the tremendous challenges of the past year, President Hartzell has stayed focused on what mattered most at UT Austin. And I'm really delighted that he is here with us tonight to tell us more. Please use the chat room function to pose questions anytime. And I know the JB will look forward to presenting them to Jay. In the meantime, it's good to see many of you on camera. And thank you for keeping your mute buttons on to avoid any external noise. Please enjoy your happy hour. Chancellor Milliken, I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, Matt. So Jay, after that introduction, I think you can only go downhill. So I did tell people to get them to tune in on a nice summer evening that you would be as exciting as Matthew McConaughey was. So we're going to see how that goes.
Yeah.
So given how many times you've lit the tower recently, you know, Matthew's book is green lights. I think yours could be orange lights.
That's right. That's right.
So one of the best things I like about Jay is that, when I asked him to do this, he said, can we have a drink during the conversation? So I told him everybody else would be. So we're going to join you. Cheers, everybody. So as Matt said, Jay came in as interim president at one of the most unusual and difficult times in higher education in modern history. There was COVID, there was national unrest, which spilled over onto college campuses. Changes in leadership in the two largest sports at UT Austin, and all the usual myriad of stuff that a president deals with every day. So here's the question I have for you. Are you glad you did it? And you can be completely honest, because there are only 150 yeah. people watching. But maybe the better question is this job, with all its challenges, worth doing?
Yeah, thank you. And I, you know, part of it, I was thinking about this is, so yesterday was the 1 year anniversary when I took over as interim, and what a year. I mean, you lined out a lot of the things that we've all gone through as in what we do. And it's been a remarkable year, you know, for better and for worse. You know, part one is, you know, when you called me that weekend, I think I came down the stairs and my wife said, "What happened?" And I said, "I think our life might be changing." And I wasn't, you know, I wasn't planning on any of this. I was happy being dean, and I was grateful for that job, and it's a great job. And then you called and sort of everything started changing. You know, I'm glad I did. I love the university, and you're very, very kind intro. You know, I went to school here. I chose to come back here. Yeah, I shouldn't tell you this, but you could probably ask me to do almost anything and I would say yes. That's part of it. It's just, you know, I love this place. I think we're at just such a special moment that I know we're going to talk more about, but who wouldn't get to, you know, take this chance when they get called if you love the place. So that part is true. And then, you know, as you think about all the good things that we're still going to get to do, I really feel like this year has been one of kind of getting over some speed bumps, and then we'll get back to the fun stuff. And, you know, that just one little tidbit on that to me was commencement. And, you know, we had 40 or 50,000 people in DKR again, and the sheer joy of the students. And it reminded me of why we do what we do. You know, we've got students out there that are really busting their tails to get through. It's hard to get in. It's hard to finish with COVID. And it was that moment of, okay, now I remember. And if I ever forget and get mired in the weeds of what we do on a daily basis, you get to see the students again, and it reminds you.
This is when I was in New York and would come home and be in a bad mood. Nana would say immediately, "You didn't see any students today, did you?" And it's true. So I used to just walk down the street and go to the dining room and eat with students just to get that rush.
Recharge.
From that. Exactly.
Yeah.
So I know you've thought a lot about this in your role as a business professor, your role as dean, and now as president, about this special place that we're in. I mean, Austin is experiencing the greatest growth of any large city in America, and such great economic development here. You know, there's a great story about Pat Moynihan when he was a senator, and somebody said, "Senator, how do you create a great city?" And he said, "That's easy. You build a great university and you wait 200 years. And I don't know if that's what's happening in Austin, but I think it's part of it. And yeah, I think now there's this symbiotic kind of effect. It's Austin and it's UT and Austin. Yeah. So what does that mean for UT to be in a place that is thriving like this? And what does it mean for Austin to have UT?
Yeah, I think it's huge. And part of what I've been thinking a lot about, and we've been starting to talk about on campus, is I believe it. I think this is a moment for UT Austin. And to me, the biggest fear I have is we wake up, we didn't try, we didn't swing, you know, we didn't really aspire to be among the very, you know, elite public universities, top private universities in the country. Because I think all the winds are at our back. And you mentioned all the stuff going on in Austin. I got to go out to see Tesla and their new facility. And anybody who's watching this and gets a chance to go see it, it's amazing. The plan is 3/4 mile long. If you count the multiple levels they're going to build out, it's 11 million square feet. They're going to start with 10,000 workers and go to 50,000. And I got seated next to the guy running the project, who's phenomenal, a guy named Omid, who works with Elon Musk. And I sat down to him at lunch and he said, "You know, we're here because of you." And he never called. It's not like Kessa called and said, "We're thinking about coming to Austin. What do you think?" They showed up and said, "We're here to a large extent because of UT Austin. And we're producing the talent they want." So part of what I think a lot about, we're all starting to talk about, is, you know, the school I went to didn't have these opportunities. The kind of ecosystem around campus was not here. It was the state university, you know, the state university, state government, and the beginnings of Dell. But now all this stuff is around. So how do we take advantage of it? It's a fun problem.
Yeah.
But we've never faced it. We've never really thought about how do you make, for example, it easier for faculty to flow in and out of campus. How do you help students connect to the Teslas and the Oracles and the Apples of the world? Just because it wasn't something we had to do in the same way. So it's a fun challenge, but to me, that's maybe the big opportunity for us.
Yeah. Yeah. So along those lines, so I think vision is a word that gets a little overworked in higher education, business and government, every place. But at the end of the day, it's the vision of a leader and the leader's team that really drives strategies and priorities of an institution. can be no better, I think, than the leadership that's driving it. So even though this is early in your tenure, can you tell us a little bit about what that vision looks like? What you think UT Austin can and should be?
Yeah, so I thank you for that. I think it dovetails nicely with the previous question. And you know, part of it to me is that, you know, we should really be aiming high because of all the reasons that we're facing. Texas is booming. Austin's booming. We're already a great place. The students get better and better. People want to be here. All that stuff. We're in the talent business. And this is a place where talent wants to be. And so if we get great students, faculty, staff, alumni together, good things will happen. So that's sort of at a high level. The other thing I talk a lot about is there's no reason to me that we shouldn't be thinking that we could be competing more with the Michigans and Berkeleys and the Cornells and Dukes, pick kind of that kind of private school. When I'm recruiting students, I'll say, you know, roll the clock forward 5 or 10 years. I think you'll have rather come from our school than Michigan because of all the things going on here now. Now there are challenges with that. We're worried more than ever about the cost of housing for our people. How do we house grad students? How do we house faculty? Our staff are being competed away by the private sector. So there are things that growth, you know, there are cons to that we have to sort through. But if you think about, I think where we can be as a university, and I know, you know, you were in New York, and you think about New York buoyed NYU when I was there, LA buoyed USC. And I think we have the same chance to move UT Austin forward in the same way as the city and the state are booming. I think it can pull us up to that level.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Now, I asked Jay to slow this down a little bit because I have a son who's a student at Michigan. And, you know, I don't want to flip it immediately.
Yeah.
But, you know, I used to talk 10, 15 years ago to leading liberal arts schools, you know, not the Ivies, but some of the best privates outside of that. And at the time, they said their main competitors were like the honors program at Michigan and the honors program at Wisconsin and Illinois. And, you know, the thing about UT right now is that it's like a big honors program. Yeah. I mean, the quality of the students, how many students applied? How many applicants did you have in the last?
Oh, gosh, let's see. So we had, it was up 15%, and we admitted probably 9,000 or so were matriculating.
Right.
So we must have had, I don't know, 50,000 plus, I mean, higher.
Yeah, I should last time number. I heard it was over 60.
I should know the number. Yeah. It was all time high.
Yeah.
Another way to think I've thought about it is, you know, we're always looking ahead at the cutoff for the next high school rule, right? The top 9%, 10%. Right. We have as many applicants now under the top 6% rule as we had under the top 9% 5 years ago.
Yeah.
So 5 years later, 9 moving down to 6, the same number of people are choosing us. So it's that part, we could fall out of bed and the students will get better.
Yeah.
It's remarkable.
I had a friend I worked with at CUNY told me his granddaughter, she lives in Brooklyn. The only place she wanted to go to school was UT. So they came to visit and fortunately she got in and she's going to be a Longhorn. She's a little bit of a Brooklyn accent, but she's going to be a Longhorn.
It's a source of diversity.
Yeah. It's such a hot place right now. It should be, because the reason that those honors programs at the big universities were so popular is that they had, you know, a lot of smart kids around you and they got great faculty, but they also had all the resources of a 50 plus thousand student university, every possible extracurricular activity and all that kind of thing, and a huge alumni base. Mm-hmm. So I think you're exactly right that this is a moment in time for UT. So here's the question I'm asked most, and I haven't looked at the chat yet, but it's probably queued up many times. Will DKR be full in the fall? and then the second question lower down is, will the campus be full and open? And what'll that look like? So what is it going to look like in those two places?
Yeah, priorities, right? I think it really will. I think the answer to both in short is yes. And if you look at, and things can obviously change, and we're all watching the data, making sure that everything holds form. But it looks really good, thankfully. And you look at where the diseases on campus and our community. We had an 11-day run, and we're running all kinds of tests, you know, hundreds of tests a day of people just to see how it's going. We had 11 or 12 days where we had no positives. So it looks really good. So we're moving towards full occupancy. We're planning on a full stadium. And we're planning on full classrooms. And the part that you know, we got to get everybody kind of on, sort of get their minds around what that's going to look like. So over the summer, we're going to phase occupancy. We're going to move people back on campus gradually so that it's not just a shock where all, you know, day, you know, tomorrow they're all here. But the full plan and expectation is that the fall of 21 will look a lot like fall of 19. We're going to try to learn some things and use technology differently. But as far as the way the classroom experience goes, it should look really, really close to normal.
I can pretty much tell you that's what everybody on this conversation wants to hear. So that's great. I'm going to ask you another question now. I'm going to come back to athletics in a minute because there's, you know, a few people are interested. But but before we do that, you know, I want to get back to what you're recovering from and why it's so important that we come back in person. So you were dean of the business school when all of a sudden that pivot happened to online. And, you know, even as an insider, it looked like it was pretty seamless that all of a sudden it just happened. And unless you knew a student or a faculty member or something, it wouldn't probably have known, you know, everything that went into that. So maybe say a little bit about, from the insiders, the real insiders' point of view, what was that like? It's like, you know, the biggest movement in higher education ever.
Yeah, at rapid scale, right? And you know, some of this, just one statistic to give you a sense of that size and that movement. When COVID hit, we added one more week to spring break. And the first Monday back where everything was online, we delivered 8 million minutes of Zoom. So from virtually zero, 2 weeks later, 8 million minutes on a day. And that was a Monday, right? So a few things that stick out of my mind of that transition of kind of anecdotes that give you some sense of what we went through. We had an accounting professor when I was dean who was 6 weeks away from retirement, and he barely knew what his mouse was. And he was in session after session, like, okay, how do I turn this thing on? What is, you know, where's my camera? I mean, and it was amazing. He could have mailed it in. He could have said, watch these lectures or something and we'll figure it out. So it really, you know, I think because maybe we had a common enemy, it rallied the people together. We had, you know, young faculty talking to faculty who didn't know, you know, how to use technology. We had, ranks didn't matter as much. It wasn't like the full professors who often have certain, you know, how this is, certain status. They were talking to people who were not on the tenure track because they all wanted to pull together to help. So that was a piece. Another part was, I think it exposed income and inequality gaps. Because we made a decision at that time, not knowing what we know today, and we sent kids home. And they were put back into worse situations in many cases than they were on campus. And part of what I've thought about now is campus is a leveler. Not perfect, but if you come to our campus, you're going to have access to Wi-Fi, technology, help, tutors, all these things. And when we, because of the disease, put people back in their environment, it made it even harder for some of our students to succeed in hindsight. So I think in some ways it was a rallying cry. It brought people together. It broke down some barriers. But on the other hand, from a student perspective, you know, some students navigated it really well, and some we put into really hard situations. So when we came back in the fall, we were really determined to do all we could, for example, to keep the dorms open, keep the parts of campus, the infrastructure of support system up, because we knew we needed to do hopefully better about supporting that part of our population.
Yeah. No, I think that's important. And, you know, one of the things, I think we always knew this, but one of the things that we were able to do by having dorm rooms open and that kind of thing is that you can take a class on Zoom, but you don't have the interaction with your fellow students. And that's such a huge part of the growing process, being in college. So at least they could have that. All right. So now back to sports.
Yeah. So after a brief interlude.
I just read that the Longhorns are the only school this year to earn NCAA tournament bids in baseball, men's and women's basketball, volleyball, and softball. And then you add to that national championships in women's tennis, which I know you have a particular interest in, rowing, and men's swimming and diving. You've done a pretty good job on your first year.
It's in my performance review, by the way.
But one of the... you know, clearly one of the big differences, I don't know what McComb's athletic program was like and your teams, but this is a big difference from being dean, being involved in this, and now being involved with the NCAA, being involved with the Big 12 in regular meetings and that kind of thing, where where you are the person who has the institutional responsibility for athletics at right. the campus. Have you enjoyed that change, that part of the job?
Honestly, I have. I mean, it's been interesting. I've learned a lot. The couple of coaching hires you made, it was a whole different experience to go through that together. You know, one part is I feel like we've all been aligned from my job to your job, the chair of the board, Kevin Eltife, athletic director, everybody's been rowing in the same direction. So that part I think has made it work well. I grew up around sports. My dad was a sports writer. And so I grew up in Tulsa, Oklahoma, which is a little awkward.
Yeah, I wasn't sure.
but I grew up around it. I love that part. When I came to UT as a grad student, I'd gone to Trinity in San Antonio, which didn't really have sports like this. And so when I got here, it was like, oh my gosh, this is fun. And so getting to be around that, I've loved. It's been a fun year, as you mentioned, in spite of all the challenges of COVID. Three national titles. We set the record for the most Big 12 championships, 13 championships in the conference this year. So there's been a lot of really great stuff. And if you look at the way things are progressing between, I think, the new hires who are still undefeated. nobody's beaten Sarkisian and Beard yet. But you look at those hires, plus the other sports, where everybody's really been doing great. It's going to be a really fun time for a while.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we're all counting on that.
Yeah.
So let's talk about, the national rankings and UT's great programs and how you compete with Michigan and Duke and the others that we want to be ahead of.
Right.
So UT's, just a couple of weeks ago in the U.S. News, UT's top ranked graduate programs, 48 programs in the top 10 nationally. Pretty amazing, yeah. Including five number one spots, placed UT in the top five public universities in the country in that. And just a year ago, UT was named one of the top 10 public universities and the top in Texas. I don't know if there are any Aggies on the call, but top in Texas, according to the Center for World University Rankings. So I think what people might be a little interested in is how do you move them up? What is it that you got a top 25 program? How do you become a top 15 program or even a top five program? Because it's not like you're the only one that's thinking about
this. Just trying to get ahead, right? Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And many of them are all trying to fight the same fights that we are trying to win, right? And a couple of ways to think about it. One way is, and some of the mechanics of things like rankings, some of those are purely reputation based. And they poll people like us and say, name the top programs in a field. Yeah. And so you want to be in top of mind of people. And so one effort we're making there, we've taken what was a communications function and added a more, what I think of as more serious marketing function. And so change the head of communications to the head of marketing communications. Because part of the deal is if we want to win a more national or international competition, we have to tell our story more forcefully outside of the borders of the state. Our challenge is not our brand in Dallas. Our challenge is national, international. So there's a part of that. The second part is it really a lot of times is driven by what I would think of as, think about a bell curve. It's the right tail. It's the stars. And if we have a few more stars and key spots in departments and fields that matter, and that could be student stars or alumni stars or faculty stars, those things start to really move the way people think about us. And, you think about, we were joking before, talking about Matthew McConaughey. That's the outcomes of him have added to our reputation as a television and film school. So if you have some of those big wins, they start to add up. So it's worrying about the really great outcomes that can happen. The other part that I'm really focused on is the graduate programs, and partly because I went to one, but we've often viewed graduate programs more like labor. And thought about them as something that's a perk for faculty, or it's something that we use to staff certain kinds of classes. And I think we really need to focus on making sure that we do our best to get more of our graduate students to go out and be professors at those kinds of schools. If we can place more of our graduate students at the Michigans and Dukes, people will start to think about us more as one of those kinds of really star places. But it means probably having fewer students who are really well supported rather than having more students who are viewed as kind of a cog in the machine.
It's fascinating to look at what successful presidents have done over decades to build their institutions. We were both at NYU for a while. You know, John Sexton was the cover story in the Times Magazine once about how he had helped transform NYU. And he said, well, I looked around at where you could win a Nobel Prize, but you didn't have to buy a lot of laboratories. So they focused on economics and they started hiring the best economists around. Yeah. They'd give them a penthouse apartment, tickets to the opera, whatever. And, you know, they've gotten Nobel Prizes now and they're a top five economics department.
I was there in finance when we hired Rob Engel from UC San Diego, and he won the Nobel Prize 5 or 10 years later.
Yeah.
And it was that same, it was that idea, right? Yeah. They were looking ahead at who is that, who are those opportunities?
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, I think, you know, we've got like New York has an ability to attract some of those people. I think we do too. And, you know, we play our cards right. It's going to happen, I think. So I haven't seen many questions on the chat. So let's keep those questions coming. I may even lower the standards and let Gordon Appleman ask a question, but no promises. But please ask questions, because I'm not going to cover everything you want to know from Jay. And besides, I'm done with the sports questions. So may have
we're going to finance next, and then you'll get more questions.
So the University of Texas system has a huge health science and medical presence. We've got 6 medical schools, soon to have 7. UT was the sort of first Texas university to have its own medical school as part of it, and certainly a different model than the UT system had had for years. So I know early on, long before you were in this role, there was some discussion about how disruptive that might be and how it would be a magnet for the budget and, you know, what would it do to the rest of the institution. I personally think it's a huge synergistic opportunity. Yeah. But how's that going? I mean, you've already had some great successes there, but I know you're not where you want to be.
And right.
There's a lot of things that have to happen. What's that like now, Heaven? This is also something you didn't do as dean of
that's
business.
That's right. Yeah, it's interesting because you've tied together a couple of these now. When I was moving into the job and knew that it was coming, the things we spent the most time on, because they were so outside my normal sphere, were athletics, healthcare, and then real estate. And so I kind of knew these were things that were not that normal in the discourse of being the dean. So, but on the healthcare front, you know, I think back to, this is to me part of why this is a moment. And we've got a new medical school. We're kind of in that, if you think about corporate analog, we're in that moment where we're going from startup to something a little more mature, but not there yet. So we're still kind of in startup that's proven itself, that's going to work, but now what's next? And we really just are just starting to nip at the opportunities for that healthcare enterprise to spill over onto campus. And so the things that we're really spending a lot of time on, one is, how do we continue to build out clinical excellence in Austin? And back to kind of the idea of how Austin's changed, you know, Austin didn't have the market or the demand to support world-class healthcare back when I was in school, right? It was just not needed. And now the market's big enough, it needs really great care. And there are probably even pockets that we might be able to do better than Dallas and Houston. So what are those opportunities? So there's a piece there around the clinical. The other piece is, because it's been new, we haven't yet seen the big spillovers to the rest of campus. And so what are the things it can bring that help us recruit the best researchers or the best students that are outside of the narrow medical side? And so, you know, you think about AI and machine learning, and we have a burgeoning partnership with MD Anderson, one of our sister schools. And, you know, Peter Pisters has been great to work with, been really excited about this idea. We can bring, for example, some AI and machine learning experts to look at their cancer data and help them think about how to model cancer development and treatment in a way that we bring what we have that's different, and they bring what they have that's different. And I think it's going to be one of those things that we can be better known and have more impact in the world around us because of that kind of an opportunity in that healthcare space.
What's the name of the computing center on campus?
It's the Odin Institute, and then the computer is called TAC.
Jay and I visited the Odin Institute together one day to look at a collaboration between that group of huge brains that have access to amazing technology resources through TAC. And MD Anderson, and how, you know, they can do things by the millions now, as opposed to small sample sizes of patients. We didn't understand any of it, but we really thought it was impressive. All these
sounded really great, didn't it? I've bragged about it ever since.
Exactly. Just don't take any questions.
That's right.
Okay, so here's a question I never thought we'd see. Can you address the controversy over the eyes of Texas?
Okay. Yeah. Shockingly.
And that is from the audience.
No, it's a fair question. It's something that we've spent a little time at over the last year. So, you know, I think, part one that I think now our people are getting their minds wrapped around is that we're keeping the song. And, you know, part of what I and I think much of campus and the alumni base, we haven't been willing to give up the idea that it can still be something that's really positive. And so many of us have viewed it in that way. And part of what I would encourage any of you who have not yet gone out and looked at the history report the committee did and watched if you start with the videos, you'll get a sense, even if you don't have time to read the 50 or 60 pages of it. But it's a remarkable story. And it's a story of a rough beginning that fits Texas and the South and Austin and the university, honestly. But then it's got this journey of, I think in many cases, the song was used in a way that was better than where the university was at that moment in time. And so because of that arc and because of where I think we can still go, I'm not willing to give up on the idea that it can still be something that unifies us. And so we're gonna keep the song, but the part that I think is on us is how do we use the song really like a lens to look at the tough parts of Texas and the South and Austin and UT. And use that as a way to teach students as we go forward. And part of what we've talked about it as a way to think about it is, you know, what do we do at UT? We do research and we teach and we try to change the world. And we've done the research now. Now we know the story. I think we know it well. We had some great historians working on that part of the project. And so that's there. Now it's up to us to teach and to move forward. And I think campus is getting there. There are some that are still upset by the fact that it's still around. And I get that. But the hope is, as we start to go forward and start to think about what are the real things that we all care about and how can we worry about those, you know, big rocks and really push on that. Then I think the song will become still something we celebrate, but also this chance to teach students about the journey of Texas and the South and UT.
So one of the, perks of being a university president is working through the legislative session on your budget. So this is your first session as president, and I know you spent a lot of time with legislators and on priorities for UT. Mm-hmm. So I'm interested in a couple things. One, how do you think we did? How do you think you fared at the end of the day? And two, in these conversations with leadership in the state and the people who hold the public purse strings for the university, what do they think of UT?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're good questions. And I'd be interested in your take too, because you've seen more of these and I was, trying to learn as I was going. Part one, how I think we did, you know, you look a year ago, pre-COVID, the belief in Texas was this was going to be the higher ed session. The session before had been K-12, everybody was, you know, interested in supporting and thinking about us and, you know, kind of the big questions around everything from admissions to how we operate, to how we can be more innovative, sort of good things. COVID hits, we had a little winter storm, people worried about, you know, power provision. And so it became, I think, really largely about dollars and cents. And at the end of the day, we had a little bit, and you know, you and I talked about it in this house before, kind of some ups and downs. I feel like we came out in a pretty good spot. And if you'd asked me where we were going to be 6 months ago and said, this is where you'll be up slightly over 2 years ago, I would have taken a heartbeat. And so, you know, kudos to the legislature, to our friends. We're in a good spot with the governor who's a Longhorn, Speaker of the House is a Longhorn, a lot of good friends of ours who are Longhorns, and also people who care about higher ed. And they get the thesis that Texas can't run and it can't attract the Teslas of the world without higher ed. So I thought they in the end of the day, they stepped up to help us. I felt good about where we ended up. We're excited about the chance to keep innovating and growing and investing both in our students and our faculty. So I felt good about that. I also felt like a lot of the things people worried about kind of, it was like the dog that didn't bark, all these, you know, and I haven't lived through as many times as you have, but those bills that I freaked out about initially never got too far. So I thought we did quite well. I think that the one bill that passed, it was not dollars and cents, it's back to athletics, which is name, image, and likeness.
Yeah.
And, you know, one thing I did not say when you asked about athletics, one advantage I think of being a business school dean is all the shocks in college athletics are making it more like a business. And so having some sense of the business dynamics, I think has been helpful, but that's the one bill that came through the session that I think is going to be, you know, part of how we think about our athletic departments running and how we compete across states and across institutions.
Yeah. I mean, the good part of that is a number of other states.
That's right.
We've actually just joined a number of other states
with
big athletic programs that have done that. And so the NCAA is going to have to adapt to that.
Yeah. Or the federal government or somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Is your sense of the session any different than that?
No, it's, you know, I'm with you. If a few months before it started, we could have had this offer, I would have taken it in a heartbeat. You know, there were a couple of disappointments from 2 years ago when we thought this was going to be a higher ed session. The TRB bill did not go, even though it a lot of work on it in the House and it passed the House. Senate had other priorities this time. You know, it's not without precedent that the TRB bill has been passed in a special session.
Right.
So it could be a bargaining chip or something in mm-hmm. in a special session. So I still am hopeful about that. There's some really important, you've got a great project on that list. But a lot of great things happened, and you know, big investment in the formula.
Right.
And I think that in part, this reflects a couple of things. And you know, you've talked about one of them, and that is how important UT is to new businesses coming in, driving. I had a meeting the other day with the CEO of Indeed, the mm-hmm. largest job seeker site in the world, 250,000 visits or 250 million visits a month. Mm. And he told me our company is built on UT. I mean, that was our growth. We started in Austin. We could have been anywhere, and it was very small. And our engineers, our computer science people, they're, you know, we are fueled by UT. And that story is not a secret. Not just the Indeed story is, but Tesla story, the Apple story, the Dell story. There are so many. And to policymakers, I think that's one of the best stories we can tell. The other best story we can tell is what the UT system and UT in particular did in COVID.
Right.
I mean, say a little bit about the UT contribution to COVID.
Yeah, the great story. Then, and I, you know, I've been on circuit with you where we both want to use it. but there's the best, and this to me pulls together a lot about what's special about UT at the moment. There's a professor named Jason McClellan. Jason McClellan was a professor at Dartmouth, and we got state money through CPRIT to build out a lab and buy two of these electron microscopes, which I now know are really expensive. And so we've got this world-class lab that matches what Stanford has, but we didn't have the professors lined up in a queue to use it. So we go out to recruit Jason, who's at Dartmouth, and you know, it's Hanover, New Hampshire. I mean, we should win that. And he comes down, he wants to use our labs. He gets the thesis of UT. He comes in January of 2018. He's one of the world's experts in coronaviruses. So 2 years later, right, the crisis hits. He's apparently on winter vacation in Park City. They call him and say, we need your help. They've identified a virus in Wuhan, China. And within a week or two, they've modeled in a 3D way the way that COVID-19 works, including something called the spike protein that attacks us. And they figured out a way to help vaccines keep something from flipping over that was going to anchor into our cells. And it's in 4 out of the top 5 vaccines and has made them more effective. And to me, it's something that in many ways, only higher ed can really do. Only in higher ed do you have a Jason McClellan, who's an expert in something that it turns out you might really need. And within 2 weeks, he has the bandwidth and the skills and the lab and the students to drive us to this place where, you know, the US is leading the charge in vaccine development. And it's people like Jason. So for those of you out there, there are lots of ways to find out the Jason story, but National Geographic has some stuff, the Alcaldes has some stuff. It's just a great story, I think.
Well, this tees up a perfect moment. Matt mentioned that we're going to do a series of these things, and one of them is about COVID. And Jason's going to be on with a couple of other experts from around the system. I'm not going to interview him because I'm not smart enough.
I was going to say that's going to be a little higher IQ level than the president.
But anyway, so we'll have, and Jason's just a compelling, I don't know if you could be charismatic if you do what he does, but anyway, he's compelling and a great story.
And we can understand.
Exactly.
He can explain
explains it perfectly.
Yeah.
So you just hired, and great that you were in a position to do this, just hired the first woman to be dean in the history of McCombs.
Yes.
So first of all, say a word about Lillian, and then what advice would you give her?
Lillian is great. Lillian Mills is the new dean of the McCombs School of Business. And you and I were joking before the camera started. I was a little hesitant to fill that job in case I needed an exit option. If you got upset with me, I wanted to have somewhere to go. So, but she's going to be fantastic. We came in as department chairs together, and it was my first kind of administrative assignment. I was in finance, she was in accounting, number one ranked accounting program in the country that she was in charge of. And she was that person in class I always cheated off of paper. And so we were doing things together, and she was always a little ahead of me. And I was always like, Lil, how did you handle this? And she was great. And then she wanted to go back to research for a while, which she did. And when then I got this opportunity, she was the one call we made to say, would you be willing to serve as interim? And the faculty were excited about her. She has such unbridled enthusiasm. And anybody who's gotten a card from her with a Bevo drawn on it or just been around her, she's really a positive force for good. And she also understands the balance of excellence in research and in teaching, and then the importance of staff and the alumni base. So we're blessed to have her in the role. She did a great job this year. We didn't go in. We went in knowing we would do a big national search because it's a national job. But it turned out we had the best candidate here all along, and I'm happy for her. The advice I would give her really is to just keep your eye on the big stuff and enjoy it. And it's a great job. The alumni base is so strong. The faculty is great. But much in the way that I was pitching that the university has this chance, I think the business school does too.
Yeah.
And it's one of the top five undergraduate programs in the country. The place where it's really, really competitive is in the MBA world. And if you want to catch the Dukes and Cornell and Carnegie Mellons, that next rung up in the MBA landscape, we have to really play up what we have that's special. And I think we have things in Austin, Texas that Ithaca doesn't have, Durham doesn't have, Ann Arbor doesn't have. So it's sort of that same thesis in many ways.
Yeah. So here's the advice I'd give her. If you read that the president is leaving, don't answer the phone.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. When this number shows up and you're like, Milliken?
Okay. So now get back a little bit to the campus political environment that we're at a, maybe an unprecedented, another overused word, but certainly in my lifetime, the most heated, partisan, vitriolic debates in the country. It isn't quite the same on the campus. And you can say what you like about the about those debates, whether they're always positive. Mm-hmm. At universities, we don't often see the same robust conflict between the extremes.
Right.
And a lot of our alumni commentators believe that universities really, as opposed to being the safe havens for free speech that they should be, are kind of monolithic in their political view. So assuming that it's a good thing to have robust speech and exposure to ideas of all kinds when you're a student. How do you do that at a place like UT Austin, or just, I don't want to pick on Austin, but a big research university in this country?
Yeah, and so really quickly, one thing is I'm open to still learning as we go. So I don't have all the answers yet, but I think it's really important. And a poll came out in the fall that really kind of broke my heart. They ranked 55 universities in free speech, and we were 54th out of 55. And that's just not, and we thought some of it was unfair. Some of it we'd already changed some things, but that's not where we want to be seen and thought of. And I think it's important for all the reasons you said. And students can't really learn if they can't hear different sides of an argument or an issue. And it's just not, it's not the environment to discover things, to debate things, to learn. So I think it's really important and part and parcel with what higher ed needs to do. So we really tried as a campus, right around the time that poll had come out, we tried to weigh into National Free Speech Week. And we asked a bunch of different units on campus to come up with activities that would lean into that to help just raise the profile. This is an issue. So that was part one. Another part is, I think as faculty, we need to model good behavior. And I was on a call just yesterday with people from faculty council leadership, and we were talking about tough issues and talking about our need to be able to sit down and show students that you and I might not agree about everything, but we can talk about it. Yeah. And we actually probably have more in common about what we want to achieve. We may debate about the path to get there, but most of the time our goals are pretty shared. So I think there's a part that is sort of faculty modeling good behavior and that kind of thing. And I also like the idea of the campus, and we've been doing things here, is trying to find people from different sides of the aisle to come to campus and to speak. And I caught a little heat in the business school when I was dean, because we brought in somebody who was really pro fossil fuels. And it wasn't necessarily an endorsement of the thesis or an anti the thesis. It was just, I thought students should hear it. And just like I think they should hear somebody on the other side of the issue. And so I think it's exposing them to things. I think it's setting the right tone. The other thing I'm excited about over the next year is to really have more conversations about our culture and values. What's it mean to be a Longhorn? What do we hold dear? And I think one of the things we need to hold dear is the ability to have open dialogue and try to find more common ground together.
Yeah. So, all right, Gordon, I'm going to ask one of your questions. Thank you for identifying yourself so I have that choice. Was there any legislation that affected the UT curriculum as it did with K-12?
Not to my knowledge. I don't know if you can think of anything off the top of your head, but I can't think of anything that did. I think we're always thinking through things that will feed into what we do.
Yeah.
And you know, K through 12 can have kind of ramifications for what we do downstream. One thing we did, and this is a little bit tying in what you mentioned previously, we did get some funding for a new institute, and we're trying to get the name right. It was billed as Liberty, which turns out some weird connections to things. And so we're debating whether it's now going to be called Freedom, but it's something around kind of free market capitalism principles. But that's an example of one where we got some funding, and that we think will reach back into K-12 to help provide some opportunities for high schools who are interested to teach some foundational principles of the role of capitalism in societal development. So that's not quite there, but it's taking a funding opportunity and deciding how to use that to help K-12.
Yeah, good. So you talk to many alums who, along with the growth of Austin, they also see more crime that you see in a larger mm-hmm. city. They have anxiety about the homelessness situation in Austin and discussion about defunding police. So I know we made a big investment a year and a half ago, maybe, in some additional police for West Campus in particular. But what do you think about that? Right. And is the campus a safe place?
Yeah, it's something that's, I think, is front and center in our minds. And I've heard a couple of anecdotes or stories from parents where they say, I'm worried now about sending my son or daughter to live in Austin. And that breaks my heart. I mean, we can't have that reputation out there as some place that is not safe for people who want to send their kids. I think part of it is growing pains as a city. And because Austin's different than it was, I think there are changes there. But there are also things that I think are not where they need to be as a city. And I know some of that's changing. And, the camping for the homeless ban should eventually help some of the perceptions and hopefully the reality. Back to your point. With your help and the region's help, we've invested, I think it's about $8 million in West Campus safety and security, really around three things. One is we now have a physical substation that is in west of Guadalupe that is there to provide a physical presence for our force. The second part is we've installed halo cameras So now there's a technology solution around the key intersections in West Campus where so many of our students live now. And then the third is hiring more officers. And we hit the accelerator on that early in the year, but because COVID had closed many of the academies, we couldn't get them on the ground yet. And so that now is finally getting there as far as getting the officers we've hired through. So we're gonna have more officers, we're gonna have better technology, we're gonna have a physical presence. And it's been really complementary to what Austin's trying to do. I think we are very fortunate to have a good force. I don't have a lot on campus of a fight between the UT Police Department and our students or our faculty or staff. That I think that relationship is quite healthy. We are not experiencing anything on campus of that kind of movement. The other thing we are going to do, which I'm excited to see how it happens and the progress it makes, we're going to put more money into adding some mental health professionals so that they can either accompany an officer or take the right kind of call. We had almost 500 calls last year where really the issue is mental health and not a dangerous situation where you'd imagine you don't want to send in somebody who's that kind of an expert, but where really the root issue was a health issue. And so we're going to staff that up and hire people to do that. And the hope is that then that will free up capacity for our officers, the more standard police, to go do what they do best.
Yeah. All right. Another sports question. So I don't even know who this person is, but since now you're really
in charge of all of it,
you're deep into all the, you probably watch the sports blogs and the sports shows all the time now. So what is your response to Feinbaum? Do you know Feinbaum?
I know Feinbaum's a national writer. Yep.
On ESPN saying UT is not a relevant football program anymore.
Oh, come on. Come on. So part one is, and this, I looked this stuff up when we were out hiring Sarkisian. So I was thinking, what's the pitch for somebody to want to come to us? And I was trying to get all the sort of facts right. So the estimated value of our football brand and enterprise alone is $1.3 billion by other people who do that kind of work.
Yeah.
We have, this just came out yesterday and it's, people have tweeted it. So it's therefore must be true. But it was a source saying, our social media and media hits and coverage and impact was the most of any university in the country. So the brand of what we do, including football and especially football, is still the biggest in the country, in spite of the fact that we haven't had the success on the field we want. So it's still a great job. We made one offer. We got the coach we wanted. I think it's going to be great again. And I want everybody to come back. Come see the stadium in the fall, a full stadium. Our end zone project is opening up. You and I toured it.
Say something about that.
That's, oh my gosh, right?
That is the coolest space ever.
Yeah. And so I'm really excited that you and I are going to be hosting people together.
Yes, me too.
And it's a south end zone project and everybody should come back. It's got a club level. It's got suites up on the side. It's got two different clubs below and it's modeled after Jerry World. So it's got that same kind of, you know, really interesting experience for fans. And it's going to enclose the stadium, make it louder, make it more fun. And it's going to be ready for the fall season. So I think all the stuff is still pointing in our direction. But to be honest, it bothers me that we haven't won at the level that we're all got accustomed to. And that drives me nuts. But Sarkisian is still undefeated.
We got all the pieces. Yeah. My favorite thing about that stadium expansion is on each side, what Chris calls Machu Picchu, the different levels that people are going to stand on, where student clubs or fraternities or others will take that space for a game. We want the opposing team deep in that end zone all the time, whether offense or defense, because that's going to be crazy.
Yep.
Okay. Let's see. Gordon's out of questions. And we're just about out of time. We got time for one or two more questions here. Let me quickly scan here. Gordon says you hired a good band director. I don't even know what that's about. What is that?
Yes, we got a great band director. And so the Scott Hanna, who did a great job, chose to retire. And we just hired a band director, Crooms, who is a UT undergrad, who went on and got his doctorate and played in the UT band, has been most recently at LSU and wanted to come home. And so he's going to be fantastic. He is the first Black director of the Longhorn Band, which will be great for our students. And as he's said on the news of the night, is that, you know, he's going to continue to listen and talk to students, which is great. But at the end of the day, the band will play the Eyes of Texas, and he'll be up on the ladder conducting the band as it goes. And so he's going to be a great leader for the band. There's a lot of enthusiasm around his hire. It's the, you know, person who was our person who went away and did great, and we got him back. So it is a lot of enthusiasm.
That is a great story. So before we close this out, you know, back to Matt's point about some of the coming attractions. I just got this today, Larry Wright's new book, which will come out next week on the plague year. It's amazing. And Larry's going to be here to talk about it. And so we'll have a follow-up to the end of October. That was fiction, but not really. And this will be just the account of this last year. And he's an amazing writer, knows more about it. Jay, you know, one of the best things that happened during my time as chancellor is that the Board of Regents named you president. And so I'm delighted that you're here and doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
It's, terrific relationship. And we talk all the time about how we can help UT Austin. And you know, maybe the difference between Jay and some others is he talks all the time about what he can do to help the rest of the system and the state of Texas. And we all start our week at 6:30 in the morning with Zoom meetings. And that conversation among our presidents, I think, would be heartening to everybody who cares about Texas and the UT system. So delighted you're here. Keep it up. And
hook them. Thanks for the chance. Thanks for the time today. Thanks for all you do to help.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Look forward to seeing you again soon.